So, hi Stella, thanks for joining me this afternoon.
Hello, Lisa. Great to be here.
Oh, thank you very much. Can you introduce yourself and tell us a bit about your involvement with the creative arts?
I'm Stella Hall. I'm coming towards the end of a long and varied career in the arts. I'm still freelance. I advise and encourage a whole range of different individuals and organisations, but I dedicate most of my time to running the Festival of Thrift in Redcar.
Right, so tell us about the Festival of Thrift.
Well, the festival arose for me out of a set of relationships coming together with a great passion for sustainability. So I, after working in Newcastle as the director of Culture 10, I went to Preston to run their Guild Festival, which happens every 20 years. So I was running a year there. I worked with some Lancashire folk, including Wayne and Geraldine Hemingway, and I told them I was coming back to the Northeast. And they introduced me to John Orchard at Lingfield Point as somebody who knew how to run festivals. So I got to Lingfield Point and found a fantastic set of buildings and the germ of an idea for a festival, and began there, just bringing people together who shared a passion for sharing old skills, creating new skills, developing a shared interest in upcycling, recycling, remaking, with artists and craftspeople at the core of it. I, at one point, I thought I was good. I mean, well, you can probably tell my background is more in the performing arts than the making arts. But at one point, I thought that was where I was heading. I was going to be a performer, but realised I was better bringing other people together and producing other people's work and helping them, to enable their ideas and bring them to fruition. So that's a lot of what the festival is about for me. Is about helping people to bring their ideas to the fore and their skills to the fore and share them with other people, whether they're amateur or professional, whether they're enthusiasts or, or newcomers or oldcomers.
Brilliant. Yeah, it's kind of the sort of midway ground that I find myself in. I'm never too sure. I think when I was at university, I got a lot more kind of focused on my own output and what I was doing. But I've kind of swung back into, this has really been my main involvement in the creative arts over the years, is that kind of facilitator, encourager, kind of role. So it's great to, it's great to include people with that kind of role in this project. We've had a few, and I think a lot of the time the people that allow everything to happen get a little bit overlooked, because obviously when you're the one out there doing the performing, you tend to get more attention.
I feel as if I get quite enough attention, and there are a whole host of other people in my team who don't get as much attention as me. But I think we've tried to up our status a bit, those of us who call ourselves producers, by calling ourselves creative producers in order to underline the creativity of the role. It's a bit of a nonsense, really, because most activities in their own way are creative, and creativity is at the core of who we are as human beings, isn't it? So to call yourself a creative
Absolutely.
producer is protesting too much, I think, but I do. I still do it.
Yep, yeah, good on you. You'd like it's it's you do have to think about these things. I've been talking to people that, interviewing people that have gone, do you know what? I'm doing something really, really important, and I'm not scared to sing about that, and even nominate people who've nominated themselves for awards because they know that they deserve it, and
Yeah.
to
Well,
bring
they
it
should.
to all the
They
work that
should.
they do.
Yeah. I mean, one of the projects I got most excited about in Teesside recently was a project we called Kaleidoscope, working with Navigator North, and that was to encourage artists to sell themselves, to be confident and to make the pitch and to ask for the right amount of money and not be afraid to make a fuss about it, because it's so easy to lose your self-confidence when you've had a couple of knockbacks, and or you know, or to value yourself, as the last person you spoke to valued you. But building your own self-worth is a hugely important part of life.
Yeah, absolutely. And as you know, talking to groups like the Tees Women Poets, and the importance of teaching stagecraft and teaching people to, you know, to get into that performance mode, that it's, you know, it's so much to more to being a performer than just that moment on stage.
Absolutely. Well, it's like everything, it's all in the preparation.
Yeah, absolutely.
Making it look spontaneous is half the skill.
Yes.
We have to make the festival look as if we just thought of it 2 days ago, and we just arrived to run a, you know, complex 2-day event that everybody enjoys. But you know, people do constantly say, "So what do you do the rest of the year?" raise the money, you know, sort out the licenses, contract, you know, do the logistics, you know, come up with the alternatives, support the artist.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm involved with a lot of Discordian productions. They're a bunch of renegade religious cult type people who worship the goddess of chaos. So many events are, you know, in celebration of chaos, but you have to spend the rest of the...
You have to plan for chaos as well.
Exactly. The chaos takes a lot of organising. So... is this always something that you've done? How did you get into it? Did you have a creative background?
Well, I studied drama at Exeter, and then I went to Manchester to study direction. I fell into television direction, but it really, you know, it really wasn't me. I enjoyed being behind a camera, but actually I wanted to be, you know, in the live field. So I started out working in community settings, you know, working on carnivals. I got involved in Rock Against Racism. I got involved in CND street theatre programmes. I joined a group of, you know, a co-op that put, you know, theatre on in the upstairs room of a pub. Just anything where people came together to make things happen, and opened the first art centre in Manchester, which was the Green Room, after putting shows on in village halls and, student buildings and outdoor spaces, moved into an art centre under railway arches there, and that for me, that Manchester model was a really brilliant one, because we were really all engaged in bringing Manchester to life and bringing it to light, and we all had a voice. You know, I was in my early 20s, you know, getting excited about running an art centre. And I was sitting at the same, you know, table as Tony Wilson, you know, Granada Television, the Hacienda, you know, the head of culture and tourism, the director of the Palace, you know, a couple of thousand seater venue. And we all had a voice. And I've always been really sort of against hierarchies in the arts, in culture, in regeneration. But, you know, that's 30 odd years ago or more. And I think still there are those who think that people working in the arts haven't got as much right to a view on how a city or a town should develop, that we're somehow on a separate track. You know, we're all citizens, we're all part of the community. You know, we care about transport and education as much as we care about the arts. You know, we're not just in one little bubble, although we're often viewed in that way.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we've certainly learned last year that we need to shout a bit louder and, you know, and take some more of the credit that's due for the enormous amount that we contribute to the UK economy, but also to the society.
Yeah, but we shouldn't have to still be doing that. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, feminism. Why are we still talking? What, you know, race, why are we still having these conversations? But we are, so yes, we do. We have to keep saying it. But, you know, there's no room for special pleading. You know, a theatre has no more right, you know, to be open than a restaurant or, you know, or any other business. You know, we're equally important in people's lives in different ways.
Yeah. I guess that's the thing, you know, it's like power, isn't it? And who gets it and how you prize it out of the hands, as we've seen, you know, in the last few weeks. You've got a lot of power. Sometimes you know, people really don't want to give that up.
No, and they don't always know how to use it well, do they?
No.
Well, I suppose it depends on what motivates you and what your values are. I mean, if you know, if what motivates you is money, then you know your actions will follow that motivation clearly. And you know, the kind of people you're referring to aren't going to be motivated by making more money.
Yeah.
That's not the motivation of many of us in the arts, really, is it?
No, absolutely not. But last year was the first time really where I've had any kind of funding, and you realise, you know, the old cliche of time and money. I can do the things that I'm doing because I'm being paid for it, which means that I don't have to sell other bits of my time in order to eat.
Yeah.
I think, you know, we've interviewed people in this project that do just make art at home for their own pleasure as a hobby. And that's brilliant. And it brings so much to them and it's brilliant for their mental health. But, you know, the idea that all artists should just be doing it in their own time as a hobby for no money is...
That's the difference between professional artists and creative people who, you know, who develop their creative skills. You know, not all people who garden are professional gardeners. You know, not all people who cook are professional chefs. You know, there's a distinction to be drawn, I'm not entirely sure why artists are constantly being challenged by the existence of creative people. You know, the two things live side by side and feed off each other.
Yeah, I have to say one really positive thing to come out of this is that the younger generation seem to just be told, yeah, go for it, go into the arts, go and fulfill your dreams. So that's really encouraging because I certainly wasn't told that. I've had to kind of claw my way back into it over decades.
What did I say? I wanted to go and work in the BBC. So I was told, do a secretarial course, learn how to type, and work your way up from the bottom. So I bugger that, you know, I never learned to type, so I still only use two fingers. Two fingers to that idea.
So I did, you know, I was told it's what my mum was, and basically I had to get a job to help pay the mortgage because my dad had a habit of just kind of quitting his job. So that's what I did. Yeah, that's been most of my life being a. Yeah.
I was very lucky to have a dad with a steady teaching job. It was, you know, he was an inspiration to me. You know, I was the eldest of nine. You know, my mother left school at 14. There wasn't very much money, but there were books galore, and I read and read and read, just immersed myself in the life. My dad taught English. He used to say, "In the beginning was the word." So I think that's probably why I went into theatre, into the performing arts much more. And I'm more comfortable talking than I am drawing, but I love to do both.
So where would the Festival of Thrift normally take place? And you know, what happened last year, and are you planning for this year?
We certainly are. Well, we were all systems go for 2020 to be running our eighth festival at Kirkleatham in the beautiful village 2 miles out of Redcar, a village with a museum and a school and a church and almshouses and fields, which we fill with every kind of performance and exhibition and demonstration and stall and, you know, peripatetic activities. But you know, come March, when our 2-year application was into the Arts Council and our 3-year plan was into Tees Valley Combined Authority, everything stopped. You know, we're a project funded organisation, we're all freelance, I'm freelance, and suddenly it all disappeared. So we could have shut up shop. But as a team we got together and thought, what can we do differently? How can we still live our our values and celebrate thrift and put artists at the core, as we've always done. So we went online, went to various online activities and events, learnt, taught ourselves, raised some emergency money from Arts Council and Red Crown Cleveland. Our sponsors all disappeared because, of course, businesses were going to the wall or, you know, drawing in their horns. But we created a secret Festival of Thrift, a hyper-local one in Broughton in East Cleveland, just for the residents of two streets. And that was an exemplar, really, of our idea of you can create a festival where you are. I mean, they did it at on VE Day. You know, we were clapping on the streets. People were making installations and images in their windows. So we took that idea and worked with some of the artists that we would have worked with in the big festival for 35,000 people, and invited them, Neighbourhood Watch, Whip It Up, Urban Canvas, Architects of Air, Fix It Cafe. We invited them to work with us in Broughton at a festival in that village. Created as you know a community meal for the people who lived there, having listened to their stories. We camped on the village green and knocked on all the doors and got to know them. And the artists that we were working with were also creating online instructions, you know, activity packs, which we distributed far and wide. They were downloadable and we distributed them in print. And we ran a digital festival with online workshop activities, a new commission on Redcar Beach, a looking to the future with Metis, with participation. All of it was online from the Palace Hub, which is our new base. Or, you know, will be when lockdown ends and we can finally take up the room that's laid empty, really, since we signed the contract with Tees Valley Arts.
Yeah, same here. I've got a studio at the Auxiliary and moved in February. So that was kind of... I've been running my radio show from there, so been in there when I can, but you know, not like I hoped.
Well, I don't live in the Tees Valley. I live in Whitley Bay, and I don't drive. You know, I'm committed to public transport, so that's a metro and two trains to get to Redcar, which I'm not able to do, able to make that journey.
No,
under current restrictions and for my own health. So
yeah,
sadly. But you know, some of the team managed to get in there. We ran an exhibition with the RIBA, who should have been building a welcome pavilion with us, young architects. But instead, they created a couple of seats and a small exhibition talking about sustainable architecture. So we managed to mount that together with the story of the festival. So we kept going and we got lots of positive feedback, and we'll continue to do that. We'll continue to be online. But 2021, my goodness, we're hoping that we're going to be able to go back to Kurt Leatham and have a large scale celebration again, and you know, and build again some of the projects that we've been talking to artists about for the last 2 years but haven't been able to realise.
Yeah, well, I certainly hope, you know, trust to hope, that's all we can do, and resilience, you know, to see us through. Yeah. It's been really lovely to meet you. You know, it's a strange circumstances to meet people in, but absolutely terrific, and I really, really hope it happens, and if so, I shall definitely see you there.
I look forward to that.
All right. Take care, Stella. Thanks for talking to me.
Bye for now.